Donald Trump, an ill-fitting suit full of chickens coming home to roost. He had a dramatic week, culminating in this on Friday evening.
Chaos erupting at a rally for Donald Trump. The violence so bad, the rally had to be canceled.
Now, let's be honest. A Trump rally being canceled due to violence is the most predictable thing to happen in this campaign since Donald Trump mentioning the size of his dick. Of course those things happened. Of course they did. And look, it doesn't feel like shutting down his events is the most effective idea, but it was hard to hear him play down any kind of role he may have had in this.
I certainly don't incite violence, and I certainly would. I don't condone violence, and I don't talk about violence.
Obviously, you know that's a lie. It couldn't be true, even if he crossed his heart with his tiny little AA battery-sized fingers. Because there have been an escalating series of confrontations at his rallies with his supporters attacking protesters, and where might they get the notion that that's a good idea?
Get them out of here. Throw them out. If you see somebody getting ready to throw a tomato, knock the crap out of them, would you?
You know what they used to do to guys like that when they were in a place like this? They'd be carried out on a stretcher, folks.
Like to punch them in the face.
Wow. Strap in, because we're in for a bumpy ride, folks. Donald Trump is one flaming guitar player away from turning this campaign into Fury fucking Road. With nuclear weapons, the most terrifying thing you can stockpile right after baby dolls. This week saw the biennial Nuclear Security Summit in Washington. All the major world leaders were there. Well, almost all of them.
One leader who could make a huge difference in securing nuclear material was a no-show. Vladimir Putin has once again snubbed President Obama.
And that is not ideal, because a nuclear summit is pretty much the only gathering where you can legitimately say, man, this would be so much better if Vladimir Putin were here. It's pretty much that. Russia had actually announced Putin would be skipping the summit a year and a half ago, which is a pretty strong statement. Normally, you only decline something that far in advance if it's a wedding save the date from your ex-fiance. Oh, nice try, Beth. As it happens, I am busy 17 months from now. Why? Fuck you, that's why. You hurt me, Beth. But even without Putin, there were plenty of issues regarding nuclear weapons to talk about, especially the fact that just 2 days before they gathered, America's potential next president mentioned that he would be perfectly comfortable with other countries becoming nuclear powers, including Japan and South Korea.
At some point, we have to say, you know what? We're better off if Japan protects itself against this maniac in North Korea. We're better off, frankly, if South Korea is going to start to protect itself.
Saudi Arabia, nuclear weapons?
Saudi Arabia, absolutely.
Absolutely. Yep. He says that with the confidence of a man who could easily find Saudi Arabia on the map if he was given 3 tries and the map only included countries ending with Arabia. And that's not all, because this week, Trump also refused to rule out using nuclear weapons in Europe for reasons including, and I quote, Europe is a big place. And it's a big place is not a good excuse for using nuclear weapons. It's barely a good excuse for peeing in the ocean. It was clearly extremely important that the president try and reassure the rest of the planet by providing some context for Trump's remarks.
The person who made the statements doesn't know much about foreign policy or nuclear policy or the Korean Peninsula or the world generally.
Yep. President Obama is basically implying there that you could fill a book with the things Donald Trump doesn't know, that book being the inside. You can see why al-Zawahiri is threatened, because even when the media is supposed to be talking about his videotape, they can't stop discussing how much more entertaining ISIS's videos are.
One of the interesting things, Wolf, about the videotape was how boring it is. You know, I mean, here is, you know, when you think about the ISIS social media campaign that they're waging, it's highly effective, it's well edited, it's exciting, there's music. Here you've got a picture of Ayman al-Zawahiri just sort of blabbing away for half an hour.
Blabbing away? Ouch! Blah, 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 am I right? This guy truly is a mass murderer. He is boring me to death. It seems that everyone has noticed ISIS's viral success, even the US government, because they recently decided that for some reason, it would be a good idea to try to beat ISIS at their own game.
The State Department has produced a counter-narrative, Wolf. A new video from the State Department, we can show you a clip of that right there as well, that it sarcastically kind of tells potential ISIS recruits that they can, quote, learn new useful skills by blowing up mosques, by crucifying and executing Muslims, as you see there.
What the fuck are you doing? The State Department has genuinely created a sarcastic parody recruitment video for ISIS that begins with the words, run, do not walk to ISIS land. And you are banking a lot on any potential militants understanding that that is sarcasm. Oh, you know what? I was just about to join ISIS, but then I saw your very clever video telling me to join ISIS, but using ironic juxtaposition of words and images to suggest that I should actually do the opposite. Just like Chandler in Friends, you know, could we be any more militant? Great stuff. I totally get it. I totally get it. Ironic propaganda is a dangerous game for a government to be playing. Believe me. Because this did not work for England when we tried to pull this shit on Germany back in 1936.
Hey, Germany, that Hitler chappy seems like he's got some swell ideas. Here's a thought, why don't you all become Nazis? And while you're at it, Poland's nice this time of year. Why don't you just pop over there and take it? That would be a really good idea. Run, don't walk to the Nazi land. Are we 100% sure they are going to get the sarcasm here?
To Land's End, the clothing company so boring, its name is literally synonymous with water. The Land's End catalogue has recently become the source of an unexpected scandal.
The retailer known for glossy catalogues like this one apologizing for what's inside the new spring issue. An interview with feminist, journalist, and political activist Gloria Steinem.
Yes, people were upset over a Gloria Steinem interview which featured such incendiary quotes as dreams are bigger than goals, each person is a unique miracle, and Land's End is helping people become themselves. Which is absurd. The only way Land's End helps people become themselves is by providing a visual expression of rock bottom. Because that is a puffy coat with lapels. Fucking lapels! It's a puffy blazer! If you see a loved one wearing that, don't just stand there. Comfort them. It's a cry for help. They're reaching out. Actually, what upset some Land's End customers wasn't so much Steinem's interview as one of her beliefs.
To do a feature on a pro-abortion feminist, it's like, why would you do that?
Pro-life customers promising to boycott the business are flooding the company's Facebook page.
The company apologized to customers who were offended, and it has removed Steinem from its website. Land's End says its goal was to feature people who have made a difference and not to take a political or religious stance.
Oh, come on. Apologizing for the interview is taking a political stance. And if you didn't want to be religious, maybe stop making all your clothes look like they're designed for Mormon spring break. Now, in an amazing added twist, Steinem supporters are now threatening to boycott the company as well. So, I guess congratulations, Land's End. With one pointless interview, which incidentally didn't even mention abortion, you've done the impossible. You've pissed off everyone involved in the abortion debate. I don't know how you did it. But by the way, since you are apologizing about things, how about apologizing for this shirt designed to look like the blueprints of a sailboat? Or whatever the fuck this is. It looks like something an ER nurse would wear to a book burning. Or maybe apologize for this beige sweater vest, which, and this is a fact, you legally are not allowed to own unless you're a middle school vice principal. That's a legal fact. But I guess it does make sense that Land's End back down here, because they know if a woman truly has the right to choose, the first thing she'll choose to do is to shop somewhere else than Land's End. And now, the party wasn't just doing damage control at the national level this week. A number of local elections also threw up terrifying results. Just look at Texas, the Lone Star State, in that a lone star is what most people would give Texas on Yelp. This week, voters in Travis County, Texas, voted for a Republican chairman, and look who they picked.
Real anger tonight after a man many Republicans considered to be vulgar and brash just won control of their party in Travis County.
I'm not politically correct. I'm politically incorrect. I'm like Donald Trump on steroids, sweetheart. So get ready to have some fun reading my Twitter feed.
Oh, For a start, that guy's overall look can only be described as guy kicked out of your gym for trying to smell women. although, in his defense, I'll say this, he's not overselling his Twitter feed, because in just the 48 hours after his election, he actually tweeted, "I am the face of the Republican Party, and I like boobies." Which is still nothing compared to my absolute favorite tweet of his, which read, "If you Google Robert Morrow 11-inch penis confirmed, you get over 11,800,000 hits, I'm just saying." Which, for the record, is not true, because we did it and we only got 472,000 hits. Although, interestingly, if you Google Robert Morrow 1-inch penis confirmed, the results go up by 150,000. But that's not the point. That's not the point. The point is, this guy is now an actual elected official, chair of the Travis County Republican Party. This guy.
Do you think Hillary Clinton would swallow your cum, or would it be more of a Lorena Bobbitt type situation? George W. Bush is like Rick Perry. Both of them were closet homosexuals. That's my personal opinion. George Herbert Walker Bush was being provided young teen boys to have sex with. I think Barack Obama is a gay man who got married. Bill Clinton, serial rapist. Hillary Clinton, rampaging bisexual adulterer. Rick Perry, rampaging bisexual adulterer.
Yes, yes, that all sounds appalling, but to be fair, the question he was asked was, what sounds does Ann Coulter make as she falls down the stairs? So, with that context, he's not entirely wrong. And look, he wasn't even the only candidate to embarrass the Republican Party in Texas this week. Let me introduce you to Mary Lou Brunner, a woman who, based on her jacket, I can only assume was a member of the 1996 women's gymnastics team. Is she Kerry Strug? I think she's Kerry Strug. She's running a successful campaign for a place on the Texas State Board of Education. So let's find out some more about her.
Brennan has recently come under fire online for some passionately stated opinions she holds, including the idea that global warming was made up to promote global socialism and that President Obama paid for a drug addiction in his 20s through homosexual prostitution.
How do people think that people on welfare who also have a drug habit, how do they think they pay for their drugs? Well, they steal, they prostitute themselves.
Say what you will about that woman, I would read any history textbook she had a part in creating. Wait, Teddy Roosevelt fathered an illegitimate child that was half human, half bear. Why did nobody tell me this? Education is fun, I yearn to learn. And look, the Texas State Board of Education is not known for having the least controversial personnel in the country, but she seems extreme even for them. She's previously written that the dinosaurs were on Noah's Ark, but went extinct afterward because, and I quote, "they may have been babies and not able to reproduce. It might make sense to take the small dinosaurs onto the Ark instead of the ones bigger than a bus." Which is clearly scientifically wrong. The reason we don't have dinosaurs isn't because they were too small to have sex. It's because nobody fucks on a cruise. The dinosaurs were probably just too full from the buffet. Crack a book, lady. Crack a science book. Now, to their credit, Republicans were quick to distance themselves from both candidates, with the current school board member saying Brunner would be a human rain delay, and the Texas governor's office issuing the statement, "Robert Morrow in no way speaks for the Republican Party or its values." But doesn't he, though? Because in this election cycle, it'd be a lot easier to argue that your party shouldn't be judged by people who spread weird Obama conspiracy theories and brag about their dicks if that didn't also accurately describe your presumptive nominee for the presidency. It's a weird election time we're going through. So let's move on. Right, I'm John Oliver. Thank you so much for joining us. Just time for a quick recap of the week, and we begin with the US election, or as you may know it, the Clown Town Fuck the World Shit Show 2016. This was a particularly big week for the Republican Party, with Donald Trump winning 7 states on Super Tuesday and 2 more last night. And while yesterday's wins were a little narrower, it does appear that Republican voters have, for the time being, decided not to make Donald Trump again. Hashtag make Donald Trump again. In fact, Trump's opponents spent the week seeming increasingly desperate.
He's always calling me Little Marco. And I'll admit, the guy, he's taller than me, he's like 6'2", which is why I don't understand why his hands are the size of someone who's 5'2". Have you seen his hands? They're like this. And you know what they say about men with small hands? You can't trust them.
No. No, that is not what they say about men with small hands. And if you can't say the word penis, don't imply the word penis. Because at that point, it's not even an insult, it's a Christian rock lyric. But even as primary voters embrace Trump, the Republican establishment is rejecting him like a transplanted organ, which is fitting as Trump does resemble a kidney dropped on the floor at a supercut. But to truly reject an organ, you need white blood cells, and the GOP called up the whitest blood cell of them all.
Now, Donald Trump tells us that he is very, very smart. I'm afraid that when it comes to foreign policy, he is very, very not smart.
Okay. And that is very, very not a very good insult. But Romney wasn't alone. Prominent Republicans lined up to publicly attack their own party's frontrunner.
I'm just hopeful that we aren't faced with the possibility of having Mr. Trump as our nominee.
I cannot in good conscience vote for him, and I will not.
If we nominate Donald Trump and put him on a glide path to the nomination, Republicans will be committing an abortion on their own party, and it will be the end of the Republican Party as we know it.
Holy shit! You know they're getting desperate when they're just throwing in their favorite buzzwords. He won't just be an abortion, he'll be a Sharia law wrapped in a Benghazi-themed gay wedding. And I mean it. I'm not understating that. I mean it. But Trump, not surprisingly, Trump hit back hard at his critics with his tiny hamster-sized fists during Thursday's debate.
He referred to my hands. If they're small, something else must be small. I guarantee you there's no problem. I guarantee it.
That's right. Donald Trump just talked about his dick during a presidential debate. A dick which I presume looks like a Cheeto with a cheese dust rubbed on. I presume, that's a guess. But you know what? I'm glad he brought it up. Mainly because I now have an excuse to play you something that we didn't have time to include last week. Specifically, an audiobook excerpt from his ex-wife Ivana's For Love Alone, a barely fictionalized account of their marriage as read by Morgan Fairchild.
In a moment, they were on the floor, on top of the mink coat, Katrinka's legs gripping his waist as he moved deeper and deeper into her. As Adam pulled away from her, his cock fell for a moment into the valley between her legs, leaving a smear of semen on the dark silk. He smiled with satisfaction. "Now you have to keep the coat," he said.
Oh, that is horrible, although... whatever you think about that, you can't say jizzing all over your girlfriend's clothes is not presidential, okay? Huh? Huh? You can't say that. But the Republican...